For God and country, that's always been what fueled him. As a student activist during the dark days of the Marcos dictatorship, as a political consultant to several administrations. And now that attorney Carlos Serapia is vying for the vice presidency, his motivation has also become his vision. A country free from poverty and injustice, a nation so great because it is rooted only in love for God. But how can he even begin to make this a reality when the very system he aims to correct stands in his way? That's where faith comes in. For Serapio, the system will not change unless the people themselves do so. And the metamorphosis will only happen if they recognize the ultimate source of all power that created the country and its resources. And he believes that time of change has come. In focus today, the vice presidential candidate of the Katipunan ng Kamalayan Kayumangi, Attorney Carlos Serapio. Attorney Serapio, welcome to the program. Thanks for joining us today. Magandang hapon po.
Magandang hapon din po at salamat for the opportunity to be on your program.
All right, so Attorney Serapio, let's begin with your thoughts on the president signing the amended Public Service Act into law. Will it make the stunted economy flourish? What consequences, if there are any, are you most concerned about?
Well, I suppose you heard what I said during the CNN as well as the COMELEC debates. And it is my position that this kind of approaches to change for as long as you have the system, the present system still in place, will be considered simply as band-aid solutions. So amendments like those of the Public Service Act, if and when the economic elite continues to have control, power over all the resources of the government, then this kind of changes, which are you may consider to be technical in nature and also legal, will not necessarily bring about the kind of change that we are hoping that can be achieved as a result of this amendment. The intentions and the objectives are definitely laudable. I am sure the president really wants to have some real change to happen, but if this power structure continues to be unitary and not shipped to a federal one, then public utility ownership as well as the operations of these public utilities will still very much be dominated by the economic elite, or what has been referred to as the oligarchy.
Yeah, so you believe that any promise of nudging the stunted growth of the economy forward will only benefit the elite and not really the majority?
Well, that has been our experience for the past 70 years or seven decades, or if you want to push it even more backwards, as Chief Justice Puno would always illustrate. We have been in this kind of system for more than 100 years. And unfortunately, any kind of economic reform or transformation that we would want to happen will not really have the desired outcome for as long as that kind of power structure is not rearranged or it is not stratified. Mm. So the proposition has been on our part that we have to break up the too much concentration of power or centralization if we want real economic development to happen. It is like one horse pulling the same cart as against 18 horses pulling the cart of the people and of the nation together. Okay, so all problems are now practically placed on the lap of the central power and of the president, the unitary system. And even if you have principles of whole of the nation approach, whole of the society approach, whole of the government approach, that kind of an approach or principle is simply not being applied as a result, again, of the obtaining power structure.
You mentioned a while ago, I'm sorry to cut you there, Attorney Serapio, but you made a mention a while ago of the recently concluded vice presidential debates. One of your rivals, Vice Presidential Candidate Rizalito David, said on this program yesterday, anybody but Bongbong, anybody but Sarah. He says the dark days of martial rule will be repeated if both win, and that now is the time to unite behind candidates who can beat this tandem. First of all, do you share that same opinion, that indeed this will be the scenario if the tandem wins?
With all due respect to the opinion which was given by my fellow vice presidential aspirant, Rizalito David, again, the proposition is that all of the presidential and vice presidential candidates operate in the old system. So regardless of who among these candidates who operate and who insist on riding the same system, the results will be the same. Doesn't really matter whether it is Pedro or Juan who will ride the horse. The horse has its own nature and character already. It will continue to ride towards this table of bad governance and this table of corruption, of injustice, of continuous poverty. That is the sad truth and reality as we see it in the Katipunan ng Kamalayang Kayumagi Party. And our admonition, if you may call it that, or proposition to our people and our leaders is to closely examine what is really wrong in the present situation. Yeah. From the point of view of power, from the point of view of power.
But the reality is, this is where we are right now. And he made that proposition. What do you think of this proposal of his to unite behind the candidates who have a chance of beating this tandem? Will you heed Mr. David's call and drop out of the race to support another?
If I may just share it, in 2009, I spearheaded a movement called as the People's Primary. At that time, we had several reformist candidates, the persons of Among Ed, of Nikki Perlas, of JC De Los Reyes, of several others, of Padaka, of Isabella. Our call for these candidates, who were actually in control of certain political power in their areas, in Isabella, in Pampanga, in Zambales, and other parts of the country, to come together and be the people's candidate and to submit themselves to a people's primary. Hmm. Now, that concept is very different from the one that is being propositioned right now. It is just like saying, oh, let's all band together because he is our common enemy. And again, unfortunately, because we see all of the candidates to be operating in the old system, we cannot at the moment align ourselves with the idea. Mm-hmm. With the idea. Again, the intention and the objective may be something that is legitimate insofar as the proponent is concerned. But insofar as our own take on our political situation is, it will not change anything. And especially when you do something simply because of spite of a personality that is, again, not in the group of our own political beliefs. Ours is not a politics of personalities, it's a politics of principles and of programs. Mm-hmm. And if we will be convinced that that is going to be the outcome of such a move, then we are going to be open to the option. But the way we see it, it will not be the case. That desired outcome will not happen, just as many other outcomes and outputs which are desired in the context of the system will not happen. And that's the reason why I mentioned about the 20 years from 66 to 86, the desired outcome, a nation becoming great again, a new society in from 1992 to 2020, the desire to go to a tiger economy through leapfrogging and pole vaulting, and the desire now for a maginhawa, panatag at matatag na bansa in 2040 to lift our people from poverty. These desired outcomes have been frustrated, not so much because the leaders are lacking in good intentions, but because the system has really served to be the primary obstacle.
So Attorney Serapio, I mean, you're not the only one who's had this vision. But if the transformation, the desired outcome, didn't happen in those decades that you mentioned, how sure are you that even if you win, that the transformation will indeed happen now? You're going up against a Goliath here, and we're talking about the system that's been fortified by years and years of misuse and abuse. How can you change it? How will you even begin?
Mere belief in one's own personal capacity will not hack it. We are not of the illusion that if my candidate for president, Brother Faisal Mondato, and I will win, our victory alone will be sufficient for that. No. The kind of move that we intend to make is really to make it real that there will be a whole of the nation, a whole of society, and a whole of government approach to it. And we will use the goodwill of our victory, of the fact that you have millions and millions of people behind you. You have to galvanize that into a force of change. You have to galvanize that into a power that can actually be utilized in order for this to happen. And that's why, instead of just desired programs, which turn out to be just promises and broken promises at that, we are propositioning a transition platform and program of government. This administration has started to prepare the blueprint when it called for a constitutional committee to review the 87th Constitution. Sadly, this was not acted upon, but the blueprint is there already. It's complete.
Yeah. Let me go back to that. During the consultation, a lot of people, at least those who support the shift to a federal form of government, they were really, you know, gung-ho about the consultation that happened. But in the end, as you correctly put it, no action was taken. Do you think that you were taken for a ride by the administration?
I don't think so. I think it was because the administration, if I may say so, there is something more presumptuous, is that it really assumed that Congress will be receptive as soon as the blueprint of the new constitution is submitted to them. But in fact, when the president addressed Congress in order to bring that matter to their attention, he said, "I am sure that when this is presented to the people will support and embrace it." He did not refer to the institutional power that has the authority to actually call for the convening of a convention or to constitute themselves into a constituent assembly in order to deliberate and finally bring this new constitution to the people for ratification. So it is a strategy that a new leadership needs to put in place. If it's only the president who will think that he can do it on his own, then he will not be able to. We will not be able to do it.
Here's the thing: he's had several chances after that to talk to Congress, to lay down his legislative agenda if he really wanted it, but we never heard from him again after that, did we?
Again, with all due respect, I hope I am not overreading the president, but the president is a realist, to say the least, when it comes to his politics. And his realism has made him see that Congress, with its present composition, is simply incompatible with the proposition for political change. When you have a Congress composed of a lot of political dynasties and supported by economic interests, the examination of the constitution that we wanted to change will show that it will hit their own interests. And it doesn't take rocket science to realize that there is that incompatibility between a program of political reform to an operating system that is going to be hit by such a program. And therefore, the realism of the current administration led by the president led to a compromise, just to be able to accept the reality. Just as I heard earlier, he was saying, we'll just have to grapple the bull by the horn, accept the reality that prices of oil will go up and up and up. But you need innovative, out-of-the-box thinking if we are really motivated by our love for our people to find solutions for them. And the reason why we're saying love of God is love of country is because you can only have that if you draw the source of your power of love from the source of love, from the one who gave us this beautiful and blessed country and our beautiful and blessed people. It's time for us just to accept that we have that beautiful thing. Stop talking, we can't do this or we can't do that. You know, let's start thinking of what we can do and what we will be able to put in place to move the country forward.
Attorney Serapio, you're well known in political circles. You know, people know of you in these circles, but not a lot of people outside of that really know you. And we want to get to know you more. In 2005, you were among those charged with inciting to sedition, as you declared a revolutionary government while calling for the ouster of then-President Gloria Arroyo. On one hand, one could see you as a defender of the country by doing that, but conversely, you could also be seen as a traitor. If you win as a vice president, can the people expect you to do the same, to defend the country to the point of going against the establishment? Or should the president be wary of you?
If I may just correct the use of the word revolutionary government. No, we did not declare a revolutionary government with the then General Fortunato Abad, former Finance Secretary Salvador Rodriguez, and Ambassador Roy Señeras. What we propositioned there was a transition government. And that's the same transition platform that we are now propositioning. I have always adopted the peaceful means in order to bring about change. I have never upheld or supported any call for a violent overthrow of government. In fact, in the most recent attempt, I was approached by people who wanted to declare a revolutionary government, even to the point of saying that the administration may be open to it. And even up to now, close to the elections, there are people still talking of revolutionary government. And I'm saying, no, it cannot be the case, because we will have to continue with the constitutional processes. There has to be no intellect as far as that's concerned. You have to have a clear definition of what revolution is and what transition is.
Okay, and, let me just cut you there. Let me just cut you there to your point, Attorney Serapio. You're saying that up to now, less than 2 months before the May 9 elections, people are still going up to you talking about establishing a transition government. So what makes this different from 2005? Why were you willing to be part of that transition government then? And why are you holding off now?
As I said, in 2005, the transition government that we propositioned called for a constitutional process. It called for the invocation of a very specific provision in our constitution, which is the protectorate provision. And that's why my proposition was to establish a constitutional protectorate as the transition government. That is very well much supported by that provision in the Constitution. And why has that been placed there? Because of the experience in 1986. In 1986, that is where you really have a revolution, because you overturned the system in a way. It was peaceful with the power of the people. But when you disregarded the Constitution at the time, which was the 1973 Constitution, the constitutional continuum, if you may call it that, was broken, and that's why there was a need to put in place a freedom constitution. Now, in this case, the reason why now that we're running, I'm presenting myself as a candidate only as a voice and a face to what a lot of people have been really longing for. Our own party obtained several millions of votes in 2019, and to me, that is an expression of their desire to already turn their backs to indict this present system and let's have a new one.
But all right, I'm sorry to cut you there, Attorney Serapio, but we're running out of time. You just mentioned a new system. In fact, you once said, itong sistema na ito has reached its point of incompetence. No matter kung anumang subsystem or sectoral reform ang gawin, hindi po maaayos yan. Ang pinakasagot talaga dito ay total system change po. Kinakailangan tumawid tayo from the old political system to a new one. So let me ask you, what to you are the factors that led us to this point of incompetence, as you call it? Maybe give us just three main factors here, which led us to the situation where we're in now.
Well, let's go to our constitution. The constitution has provided for an end to political dynasty for the past, how many years, 35, mm-hmm. 35 years? Our legislators have failed to pass a enabling legislation. So when it comes to political dynasty, the system is simply not able to respond to it 35 years after it was provided in our constitution. Our constitution has always provided for the kind of economic principles that will lift our people out of poverty. But look at where we are right now. Have we really been able to improve the quality of lives of our people? I think it is the general sentiment that we have not been able to do that. Third, insofar as our own adaptability or the way we have adapted to the new realities in the world, we are definitely lagging behind, because it's only a ruling few that continues to determine the destiny of our people and of our nation. It will, as I said, it will not take rocket science for us to see. You know, we're doing things over and over again, and we expect a different result. We're always looking for a white knight. Hmm. And yet, regardless who that white knight may be, male or female, who will ride the horse will go to its desired direction. No one can rein it. So you need the sovereign power of the people to be organized. And that is what the political party is trying to do, for the sovereign power of the people to have a vessel, to have a bicycle,
a vehicle.
Yeah. Political leadership, political technocracy, and political organizations, all of those components are with our political party.
And we also know, Attorney Serapio, sorry, but our audio is really overlapping here. I really apologize for that. But you're also known as a proponent of a federal form of government. For example, let's talk about reality now. How could the country have handled this COVID crisis, managed it better if we had a federal form of government? And when we talk about economic recovery efforts, for example, post the pandemic, if we had a federal form of government, how do you think we could have managed?
A principle of federalism is subsidiarity. In other words, Where the problem arises, that is where the immediate solution should come from. When the pandemic hit us, it was only in a specific place. There were less than, I think, just 60 cases. But what we did we do? We declared totally the response in the entire country. It was only later on, after we have had our own experience, that we granularized it. To say granularized response to the pandemic is to realize that that is where what it should have been, at the lowest level of government. In a federal form of government, that would have been the case, because, as I said, it operates on the principle of subsidiarity. Mm-hmm. The crisis that we have right now also, not just the health crisis of the pandemic, but the economic crisis, et cetera, and everything, that will be addressed a lot if mm-hmm. you are going to break up the power structure in that way, but at the same time continue to have a very strong political center, which is the design of the Puno Bayanihan Federal Constitution.
All right.
A lot of thought, a lot of research was placed into the crafting of that constitution. And I'm begging our people and our leaders, let's take a look at this. Let's set aside our political differences and start looking at what is necessary for us to move the country forward.
Attorney Serapio, a while ago we were talking about federalism and how you think it will solve our current problems as we speak if we only had federalism in place. But what do you say to those who fear that federalism will only give rise to fiefdoms and that it will only solidify the hold of dynasties on our political system? Attorney Serapio.
An examination of what has been proposed in the Puno Bayanihan Constitution will show you that that will not really be the case. So a more in-depth study of those provisions. But since we have limited time, let me just say, you imagine it in terms of the political dynamics. You have a dynasty in province A, dynasty in B, C, D, and E. Now these dynasties, the fear is that they'll just come together in order for them to allocate to each other the power that is going to be given to the federated region. Well, you know how it is when it comes to political behavior and the kind of political culture that has been ingrained in our politicians at the moment. It is not easy for them to surrender their power simply just so that they will be able to get still a piece of the power cake. That is simply not the case when it comes to the present obtaining political culture and behavior of our politicians. Rather, the five of them will be competing against each other, and that will provide the opening for new political parties, for new political personalities of those political parties to have a better chance of really now competing for political power. Mm. The other thing there is that it will be able to present to the people more clearly, because the region is closer to those who live in the provinces which constitute them, to examine likewise what are these programs that are being presented to them. Okay. So all you need to do is really study the dynamics, and you will know that that will not really be the case. These are fears which are being said and brought out there in the open in order just to say that, you know, it's better for us just to stay still in where we are rather than experiment with something that we think may really just bring us to a worse situation.
Well, Attorney Serapio,
political dynasties on the local.
Yeah, Attorney Serapio, we're not going to sit still now, as we are going to move on. And I want to know about your thoughts on issues involving the country as we speak. Before you, right now, are six images, six topics. You get to decide which topic you want to discuss first. May I have your first choice?
Well, let's discuss with the pandemic, because
all right,
the other features also can be addressed by what I'm going to proposition when it comes to the pandemic.
All right. So when you talk about the pandemic, Attorney Serapio, what would you have done differently in government's pandemic response?
It should be treated as a multidimensional problem, not just as a unit. Just a single dimension problem, which is a health issue or an economic issue or social issues. These are interconnected problems. The proposition that we're making is immediately, in order to address that and all the aspects of the problem, we are propositioning the solarization of the nation, beginning with the solarization of all government premises or physical holdings or their buildings of government. Why? Because right now, the way we are treating the pandemic is it is a magnified amelioration kind of response that we are giving it. So we give so many billions to this sector, this other billions to the other sector, all of which will simply just be consumed in a few days. That was our experience when the pandemic first struck. The administration was so confident that because it had 300 billion in reserve, it can address it. But when the pandemic lasted more than the projected period when it can actually be arrested, we had to borrow, etc. So the kind of response must not only be consumption and amelioration oriented, it must be productive. There has to be production, even as we and solarization of government offices is a solution. We have a complete program on that.
All right.
By our technocratic of the party.
Your next topic that you want to discuss, Attorney Serapio, you have the Marcos issue, education, you have climate change, crime and corruption, and foreign policy.
Okay, let me just go through them one by one now.
Which one do you want to discuss first? You choose a topic, I ask the question.
All right, okay. As I said, I'll go through it one by one. Mm-hmm. I'll do away with the Marcos issue first.
All right. Attorney Serapio,
any program.
Oh, really? Why is that so?
Because we're looking at the current political contest as a system against system. We don't want to get embroiled in this personality competitions or contests and these animosities which may be out there.
Okay, no, I get
that
you.
That to us is a part of the...
I get you, all but right. he is not just a candidate. He's not just a contender. He's also, he has become a campaign issue as well. Why do you think this is so?
I will have to look at it in terms of the mindset of our people when it comes to that. After almost how many years? 46 years?
36.
From 1986, 36 years. We have not resolved this. Why have we not been able to resolve it? Our people continue to be divided on this issue. And division is the last thing that we need in this country. So you may have the right message of unity, but if you have the wrong messenger, then it will not happen. And unfortunately, the message is wrong regardless of who in the current system will deliver it. If they were not able to resolve it in 36 years, how will they be able to resolve it? Now, the same people who are propositioning here, I know personally for a fact, because in 1992, when President Ramos won and the family of the Marcoses came to know that I have access to them, I was asked personally, and I'm not breaking any kind of lawyer-client relationship here, confidentiality, I was asked to deliver the message to President-elect Ramos that the Marcoses were willing to talk regarding this issue of the wealth, and I did so. And the president at the time appointed someone who will handle the negotiation. And I know also what happened during the negotiations. I am also, in a sense, doing some kind of back channeling between the family then and also the administration on how this will be done. We know for a fact that there was actually an agreement that was reached between the government there and the Marcos family,
so
which
eventually,
as I understand it, was struck down.
So if I were to... So if,
court.
I'm sorry, Attorney Serapio, because we're running out of time, and please make your answers brief. So if I were to ask you, if there was one thing that could finally put this issue to rest, what do you think that is? What should government do? What should the Marcos family do?
Turn your backs on the two competing families that have been bringing this issue to our people. The higher moral crime is that as we process this issue for the past four decades, our people are getting deeper into, pardon the word, into deeper shit. You turn your back against those who are using these issues for political reasons or whatever purposes. I mean, and that's an indictment of this system. That is what you need to do. Our people need to look to a new way of resolving that issue that has become morally convoluted.
All right, let's move on to the next topic. You want to go to education? Attorney Serapio, I could help you along.
Well, education simply has to now adapt to the new realities in the world. We may have already pre-kindergarten education, pre-public elementary and high school education, and even pre-tertiary education. But if the educational system is not adapted to the imperatives of the new realities of the times, then what you'll have, you'll be just contributing more educated people into the ranks of the unemployed. You have to have a change in the paradigm of how education needs to be done in our country.
All right, let's go to climate change now, Attorney Serapio. Will you end the country's dependence on fossil fuels and coal-based plants and push for renewable sources of energy if you win as vice president?
Most definitely, because as I said, our political parties aligned with the group that is precisely addressing this issue. Our call now is massive solarization, not in the way that it is being done at the moment, because we have a group that has developed a program that will make us productive as we harness the power of the sun in order for us to address all these climate change issues, all the energy issue, And we will also be addressing the economic issue, the health issue, the political issue, simply because we are focusing on a primary flagship program, which is massive solarization, beginning with the solarization of government offices that will save us something like 150 billion pesos because of the 300 billion that government also pays for its own electric consumption. That is on the table, and something that you may be interested to look into.
All right, let's talk about crime and corruption. And now, as you know, these are not separate and distinct. In the Philippines, corruption has become a tool to protect the criminals both in and out of government. How will you break the ties that bind the two if you win as vice president?
You begin by dismantling precisely the control and power of a few over our politics, our economics, our regulatory systems in government, and all the other agencies of government where corruption actually not just persists, but it is definitely has been syndicated. Power is at the root of that. When you say power corrupts and absolute power corrupts absolutely, there is a truism in that principle. You will have to look at it and how it is applied to a system that is based on an oligarchic power and on dynastic power. And you will note that that is what actually feeds corruption, and that is actually what even feeds crime in society. Why? Right. Because of the social divide.
Let's talk about foreign policy now. President Duterte's independent foreign policy was widely welcomed in the beginning until it turned out to be more of a pivot to China. You were also quoted to have said that if given the chance, you would like to be assigned the foreign affairs portfolio. What kind of foreign policy will you endeavor to pursue? Should you win the vice presidency, and should that portfolio be given to you, Attorney Serapio?
It will be one that is adapted to the globalized nature of the international community now. So it is not simply independent, but it is interdependent. Well, this is something that I would not want to consider as original from my own. I got my education on this to a certain extent from President Ramos, who is the primary proponent now on interdependent foreign policy. So in an interdependent policy, I will not be discussing foreign policy strategy or foreign policy preferences in public, even during the case, for example, of a campaign or a debate in election season. We stick to foreign policy principles. And as early as in the 1950s, we were a leading light when it comes to foreign policy. And that's why at the Bandung Conference, we were among those who immediately propounded for the policy or principle of non-aggression, of the principle of non-interference, the principle of cooperation and mutual benefit among nations, of the principle of peace, and the principle of a just ordering of the international community. System. So those principles should be the ones that should guide us whenever we now develop our foreign policy. At the same time, we have to have that kind of sense of geopolitical realism. We have to understand real politics in the context, again, of the power centers in the world. Take the present case now. We have to know exactly the mindset, not just of the country itself, because the country itself can have a mindset. It has a consciousness developed through history, and also the mindset of the current ruler of the country.
All right.
You need to have clear political intelligence to guide you on how you will respond to a situation, especially to an international crisis.
Attorney Serapio, we've reached the end of the interview, but before we let you go, here are some rapid-fire questions, quick answers, first thing that comes to mind. And here we go. Last book you read?
I'm sorry, I didn't get it.
What's the last book? Last book that you read?
The World Order, which was an old book, but I revisited it.
Last message or last text message you sent?
Ang pag-ibig sa Diyos ay pag-ibig sa bayan.
What's your playlist like, Attorney Serapio? Do you listen to music?
Yes, the music of the 70s, definitely.
That's a good decade right there. Are you a morning person or a night owl?
I'm more of a night owl.
All right.
Night owl.
last show you streamed or binge watched, do you still have time to watch shows?
Which one? I'm sorry.
Last show that you streamed or binge watched?
Unfortunately, for the past so many months, but the last, if I remember correctly, is a Korean political telenovela.
I know what you're talking about. Which law in the Philippines is the most outdated for you, Attorney Serapio?
The law in the Philippines?
Mm-hmm.
Right now, it's the Constitution.
All right. If Faisal Mangondato is not your running mate, who would it be and why?
Someone not in the system. So please forgive me if I don't mention any name, because I see no one who is not inside the system right now.
Do you believe in surveys, Attorney Serapio?
Yes, as a scientific tool, yes, I do.
So if your answer is yes, but why continue on with your campaign knowing that you're among those trailing?
That is a political disruption is the beginning of real transformation.
Attorney Serapio, would you rather lose and be given a cabinet position or win and be treated as a spare tire?
Well, may I answer that not with a single word?
Just make sure it's brief, because you're running out of time.
Yeah, as I said, political disruption is the beginning of social, economic, and political transformation. We've been given the opportunity to be able to deliver our message to our people. The most important thing for us is what we have been inspired by our discernment, that the experiences that I have gain through all these years is something that I need to share to the young, to the new generation. For them, if only for them to realize that they need to have a hard look at where we are at the moment and where they should be focusing their energy, their interest, in order to help move the country forward. And for them to recover their good old virtues and values as a people. So,
Yeah, Attorney Serapio, which measure would you... Sorry to cut you there. Which measure would you push for if it will give you an assurance of winning the vice presidency? Will it be same-sex marriage, legalizing abortion, or a law on divorce?
The legislation in our transition platform that we are definitely going to vote for on day one itself is for us to convene a constitutional convention. But on those issues, I beg the indulgence of those who are interested in these issues. I definitely respect the respective positions on that. But as a telescope to where we are as a people and as a nation, I think those are sectoral interests that needs to be addressed in the same way. All due respect to them, to those who consider this as very important in our current life as a people, as a nation right now.
All right. Best president we never had, Attorney Serapio.
I worked for a long time with Raul Manglapus. And, he may have, Claro M. Recto. These are the people I'm looking at. Mm. Claro M. Recto, Raul Manglapus, and those two.
And finally, Attorney Serapio, you just found out you won the elections. What's the first thought that comes to mind?
Praise and glorify God, because that can only happen if God, in His infinite wisdom and power, should create conditions for us to really be able to attain political power. But I'm assuring you, we have so many people working silently on the ground from the ranks of spiritual groups like the Kapatira Spiritual ng Pilipinas, from the ranks of change advocates like the KPM or Kamalayang Pinoy movement, from the ranks of our Muslim brothers who also want a peaceful process of change, from the ranks of BSBP, the Bagong Sistema, Bagong Pag-asa. As you said earlier, I'm quite known politically in several circles, and thank you for saying that. I'm humbled by it. What? But on the ground, I've also known these organizations that we have put in place. It's just that we need this kind of exposure that you're giving us, and we thank you for it. And we need to harness more the social platforms. We need to veer away from the traditional way also campaigning on the grassroots.
Yeah.
But our
Attorney Serapio, I'm really sorry to do this, and I beg your indulgence, but we really run out of time, and we do have to cut this interview short. But I do appreciate you coming to the show, talking to you. In fact, I enjoyed our conversation that just happened. Vice Presidential Candidate of the Katipunan ng Kamalayang Kayumanggi, Attorney Carlos Serapio, thank you for joining us today. You take care and you keep safe. And
thank you very much for the opportunity. And in our transition platform program of action, I beg you to examine it carefully.